Hey everyone, Kyle Bascombe here. Today we're going to be talking about the Mercedes M274 engine. All right, so we're here to talk about the engine that no one really wants to talk about, but we just see it popping up in just about every model. What I like to call the Mercedes Volkswagen 2-liter turbo. This is a 2-liter four-cylinder engine that Mercedes introduced, a very high feature engine. So we're talking turbocharging, direct injected. We've got variable cam timing, all aluminum for the block and heads. Just something that you typically don't see from Mercedes. Normally you're accustomed to seeing V6 or V8 or V12. Things are changing, engines are downsizing. Mercedes is embracing a more modern way to construct engines. So whether you like it or not, these 2-liter four-cylinder engines are definitely here to stay. We're seeing them offered in every model, similar to what I mentioned, SLK, E-Class, C-Class, GLC, and even the variants that are transverse are based on this M274 motor. So because it's here to stay, we're gonna go over all of the common maintenance items that we recommend you perform, as well as the common failure points. So we've got a lot of the more common maintenance items laid out on the table, but to be quite honest with you, it's a large engine bay, it's a four-cylinder motor, it's gonna be much easier for me to show you what's going on right on the vehicle. So let's go over to the vehicle and we'll get started talking about common maintenance items, as well as some of the common failure items on this platform. All right guys, so we've got the M274 engine here. As you can see, four cylinder, longitudinally mounted. I'm gonna take some things out of the way so that you can really see some of the components that we're diving into. So as you can see, we just have the air snorkel kind of hanging out here, and the cosmetic cover for the engine. Just gonna pull that off, set it aside right there. All right, so just starting over here and working our way across the engine, the first thing I want to discuss with you is the engine air filter. As you can see, super easy to get to, very easy to replace. Three Torx bolts and this comes right out. This is something you should consider replacing every second oil change or so. Make sure that you don't have any restriction in the turbo system or an old filter in there that could present issues downstream with sediment getting into the engine and causing other issues. When we removed the filter from this car, it was actually the original filter. From like 2016, which is kind of scary. Moving into the turbocharger, sits on the passenger side of the engine. This particular turbocharger is an integrated unit where the exhaust manifold and the turbo are single assembly. Not really too much trouble on this unit. Sometimes the vacuum system does give issues and you're gonna get boost codes for that where there's no boost being supplied at all. Unfortunately, the control systems for these turbochargers are not available separately. Sometimes you might end up replacing the entire turbocharger assembly. One bit of a tedious job on this motor is actually the water pump. The water pump actually sits on this side of the engine. As you can see, you're going to need to take out the air intake assembly, this entire air line, which actually doubles as a portion of the PCV line, and then you'll have access to the water pump. So moving on to the ignition system, your ignition coils are featured right at the top of the engine here. Really very accessible to get to. What I'd be recommending in terms of a replacement interval is every 30 or 40,000 miles, consider replacing your spark plugs. These NGK plugs are the OE plugs. Only thing that I would warn you of is on the box, there's definitely a recommendation for how you want to torque this. This has got an angle torque here. Use the torque value that Mercedes recommends, which I believe is 23 Newton meters. What happens is the plug is indexed in a specific way in the head, and if it ends up shielding the injector or something like that, you can burn a piston. Hundreds of other horror stories related to not using the correct plug and not torquing it the correct way. Whenever you replace the spark plugs, at the same time, it's going to be a really good idea to replace the ignition coil boots. They come pre-greased already, so you don't have to worry about using dielectric grease. Sometimes these do get seized in the spark plug tube. If you're replacing them every time you replace the plugs, you're probably not gonna run into that issue. When you're removing the coil, just instead of holding the coil at the head and pulling it up, hold it closer to the boot and pull it out, and you shouldn't have any issues at all. While we're over here, unfortunately, another common failure item is going to be your direct injector, your fuel injector. It does require removal of the entire rail. So the rail's coming out, all of this harness that you're seeing here is coming out, this bracket for your high pressure pump. So there's a little bit of a laborious job. It does require some special tools, which we do have listed on the website that allow you to both remove and install the injectors. Mercedes, unlike a lot of other makes, does not require you to replace all of the injectors on a bank. So if you have an issue with cylinder one, you can replace just cylinder one and move on with your life. While we're talking about cylinder one or individual cylinders, a lot of early, so let's call it 2015 and 2016 M274s did have issues with the pistons, specifically the wrist pins on the pistons. At the dealer level, it's not uncommon to see a dealer replacing a piston to resolve the problem. It does sound like an engine knock, like what you would get if you had like a rod bearing failure. So you're going to get a knocking noise. It's going to sound like it's coming from like the axle area of the engine bay, so a little lower down. If you hear that, you really don't want to ignore it. You do want to have it addressed. There are cases where you might be able to get a good faith replacement from a dealer. Sometimes you're gonna have to eat it and take care of it yourself. But just something to be aware of, these engines did have piston slap issues. Moving back into maintenance items at the front of the engine, drive belt, idler, every 50 to 60,000 miles, be sure to replace those. So we're kind of done here on the passenger side. I'm gonna move over to the driver side of the engine. We're gonna talk about some of the components located there. So now that we're on this side of the engine, I'm going to continue to discuss components that are on the other side of the engine. So when it comes to the cooling circuit on this motor, there are two separate circuits. One's going to be for your engine cooling system and your turbochargers. The other is going to be for your transmission, actually, and your charge air intercooler. Charge air intercooler circuit has its own expansion tank, and it is driven by the electric circulation pump. That's a circ pump that's located in this bottom quarter of the engine bay. For the engine and for the turbochargers, you have a belt-driven water pump. That's the pump that I mentioned that was in this area. Really not too much in the way of trouble or failure symptoms for the cooling system, but it is still important that you look at your turbo oil cooler lines and your coolant lines to make sure they're not weeping or leaking, because that will cause more issues if the system continues to stay open. On this side, we also have your thermostat. If we are going to talk about a common failure item for the cooling system, this is going to be your most common failure item. So if you notice that it is taking a while for the engine to get up to temperature, or if you have codes related to the thermostat, you're definitely going to want to replace that as soon as possible. Certain features will begin to not work properly. For instance, if your vehicle is equipped with Eco Start Stop, actually which they all should be, your Eco Start Stop might not work anymore. You may have trouble getting heat into the cabin. You might get codes for other systems. So just something to keep in mind and something that you're going to want to address as soon as you notice issues with it. All right, so next thing I want to discuss is the PCV breather system. A little bit of a complex system on this car. Well designed. So what happens with this system is it is a heated system. It's got two air oil separators, one up here at the valve cover, one at the block. And what's great about it is it does cut down on a lot of the carbon buildup that you typically see on these 2-liter direct injection turbocharged motors. It's not as bad. It doesn't gunk up as much as you see on the motors from a lot of other makes. But unfortunately, this PCV breather system does fail regularly. And Mercedes is on their fourth or fifth revision at this point. And the part that they're currently offering is actually a remanufactured part. The trouble code that you're going to get for that system is a P052E. If you start seeing that code and you've got no other issues with the cooling system, like I mentioned earlier, unfortunately, you're gonna have to throw a breather line assembly at it. There are times when you can get away with replacing just an air oil separator if the air oil separator is clogged, but what's more common is a torn diaphragm or the heating system for the PCV circuit. So you really wanna be replacing that entire line assembly. All right, so although we've covered a lot in a short period of time, at the end of the day, easy motor to live with, very fuel efficient, If you're into tuning, there are tuning options out there. We're seeing this motor on a bunch of platforms, not just Mercedes. It's actually used in some Nissan and Infiniti products as well. And at the end of the day, everything that we discussed here, we're going to be completing DIYs on as well to help support you guys. So let's go back to the table and we're going to close things out here. Well, guys, we just wrapped up discussing the terrible but not so terrible Mercedes M274 engine. In terms of working on the engine, in terms of maintenance and items to look out for, we did go through a healthy list of items, but at the end of the day, it's not a hard motor to work on. It doesn't require that much in the way of special tools. Some of the jobs are a little bit tedious, so there's a bit of a time investment. That's about it. If you own or live with a Mercedes M274 engine and there's something that you would like to see us discuss, or if you have questions, be sure to leave them in the comments below. Like and subscribe. Thanks for watching.